What's up, guys? Few things are as frustrating for sports fans, pundits, coaches, and players as seeing guys get snubbed from the Hall of Fame on an annual basis. Some guys have to wait decades until getting their call. Think of Green Bay Packers legend Jerry Kramer. He retired in 1968 and didn't receive an induction until 2018. Every NFL team has at least one guy who more than deserves a call to the Hall, but it simply hasn't happened yet. Let's dive into the biggest Hall of Fame snub for all 32 clubs. Here's hoping these guys receive the induction someday. Make sure to subscribe to TPS and put on your notifications, because we post videos all the time. New sports content all the time. Subscribe. Make sure to comment your video ideas down below. We'll be looking, and if you choose your idea, we'll give you a shout out in the video. Arizona Cardinals, Marshall Goldberg. Goldberg spent his entire career with the Chicago Cardinals, where he shined as a star halfback. Goldberg was a key part of their 1947 NFL championship team. He earned 4 All-Pro selections as well. Goldberg was a finalist to be elected to the 2008 Hall of Fame class, but unfortunately he didn't make the cut. But never say never. Atlanta Falcons, Tommy Nobis. He spent his entire NFL career with the Falcons, where he played from 1966 to 67. He won the Rookie of the Year award, earned 5 Pro Bowl selections, and was named to the 1960s All-Decade team. He was one of the most dominant defensive players of his era, and it's beyond us how he hasn't been inducted. I mean, I guess it didn't help that the Falcons were among the NFL's worst teams during his playing career. Baltimore Ravens, Jamal Lewis. He only earned 1 Pro Bowl selection, but Jamal Lewis was among the NFL's most prolific and dominant running backs during his time with the Ravens. He was a key part of their Super Bowl 35 championship team. Lewis also won the 2003 Offensive Player of the Year award after leading the NFL in rushing. Lewis ranks 24th all-time in career rushing yards with 10,607, and he posted 58 rushing touchdowns. I mean, for me, that's enough for a call to the Hall. Buffalo Bills, Steve Tasker. He's one of the greatest special teams weapons of all time. Tasker was part of the 90s Bills powerhouse that reached 4 straight Super Bowls. He earned 7 Pro Bowl selections in his career. Tasker was one of the first true superstar special teams playmakers. Before Devin Hester, it was Steve Tasker appearing on all the highlight reel plays. This guy has more than deserved a spot in the Hall. If he never makes it, I mean, what special teams player will get in? Carolina Panthers, Wesley Walls. After stops in San Francisco, where he won a Super Bowl, and later New Orleans, Walls joined the Carolina Panthers in 1996. He took his career to another level from there, earning 5 Pro Bowl selections and 4 All-Pro selections. He played a key role in helping Carolina reach the NFC title game in just their second year of existence in 1996. He probably didn't put up enough stats to receive a call to the Hall, but I mean, we just had to pick at least one Panther who was snubbed. And without question, it's Walls. Chicago Bears, Jay Hilgenberg. The 80s Bears squads are best remembered for that legendary defense that beat and battered the competition. The 85 Bears, widely recognized as the greatest defense unit of all time, guided the organization to a Super Bowl XX championship. But people overlook center Jay Hilgenberg, who anchored that offensive line, creating holes for Walter Payton to break through. Hilgenberg earned 7 Pro Bowl and 5 All-Pro selections. What more can an offensive lineman do to receive an induction into Canton? Cincinnati Bengals, Chad Johnson. The Bengals sure don't have much of a winning history. But boy oh boy was Chad Johnson ever a winner during his decade-long tenure in Cincy. Known for his strong personality and excessive TD celebrations, Johnson was one of the NFL's most prolific offensive playmakers during the 2000s. He was named to 6 Pro Bowls and led the NFL in receiving during the 2006 campaign. He recorded 7 1,000-yard seasons in his career. His 11,059 receiving yards placed Johnson just outside the top 30 all-time. To us, he did more than enough to get it. Cleveland Browns, Dick Schaffrath. Schaffrath played for the Browns from 1959 to 71. The perennial Pro Bowl guard played an integral part of the Cleveland's 1964 NFL championship team. He also earned 4 first-team All-Pro selections in his career, but it seems like this Browns legend will never reach Canton. But hey, the PFRA named him to their Hall of Very Good class of 2007. That counts as something, right? Dallas Cowboys, Darren Woodson. The vast majority of star players from the 90s Cowboys dynasty are already enshrined in Canton, but superstar safety Darren Woodson is not one of them. Woodson played a huge part of Dallas' 3 Super Bowl championship teams in the 90s. The 4-time first-team All-Pro was arguably the best safety of the decade. Canton has never released a statement on why Woodson hasn't been inducted, and we don't know why. Denver Broncos, Randy Gratishar. Before John Elway arrived in 1983, this guy was the heart and soul of the Denver Broncos. The stud linebacker absolutely dominated in every aspect. and he was the anchor of the legendary Orange Crush defense. He won the 1978 Defensive Player of the Year award and racked up 2,049 tackles in his career. Few linebackers ever played at an elite level for a decade like he did. His annual snub for the Hall of Fame is impossible to understand. Detroit Lions, Alex Karras. The athlete turned actor was among the NFL's best defensive linemen of the 60s. He unfortunately joined the Lions after their stretch of three NFL championships in the 50s. He was stuck on a club that just never really was much of anything during his tenure. Nonetheless, he showed up and made an impact every night. Named to the 1960s All-Decade Team, he was also enshrined in the College Football Hall of Fame. We think he belongs in the other hall, but anyway, moving on. Green Bay Packers, Sterling Sharp. No question that Sharp would be in it if it weren't for a scary neck injury that ended his career in 1994. But one can argue that Sharp did more than enough to earn his spot before that. Sharp earned 5 Pro Bowl selections, 3 first-team All-Pro selections, and he led the league in receptions 3 times. He was the go-to target for Brett Favre, and Sharp deserves plenty of credit for helping number 4 develop into a top-tier QB. Young brother Shannon is in the hall. How epic would it be if Sterling got to join in there? Houston Texans, Arian Foster. Andre Johnson is probably the only retired Texan with a shot at the Hall of Fame. Thing is, he's an absolute gimme to get in once he's eligible. So we'll go with 4-time Pro Bowl running back Arian Foster here. No, Foster isn't eligible yet either, but who else would you pick here for the Texans? We know he won't get in, but there's a small case to make here. He led the league in rushing during the 2010 season.
No, Foster isn't eligible.
Foster also earned first-team All-Pro selections in 2010 and 2012. He led the league in rushing, slowed him down for large portions of his final 4 NFL seasons. Indianapolis Colts, Edgerrin James,
2012.
When people think of that 2000 Colts juggernaut, they think of Peyton Manning, Marvin Harrison, Reggie Wayne, and Dallas Clark. But everybody forgets about this guy,
Edgerrin James,
productive workhorse running backs.
When people think of that 2000,
was busy destroying defenses in the passing game. James, everybody forgets about this guy,
one of the most productive.
He recorded 7 1,000-yard seasons.
People think of that 2000,
and he led the NFL in rushing twice. James, 12,279 rushing yards, one of the most productive all time. He was the model of consistency. Jacksonville Jaguars, Tony Boselli. Widely regarded as the greatest Jaguar of all time, he probably would have reached Canton if injuries didn't force him to retire in 2002. But over his 7 seasons with the Jaguars, he was among the NFL's elite offensive tackles. He was a 5-time Pro Bowler and was named to the 1990s All-Decade Team. He also helped the Jaguars reach the 1996 AFC Championship game in just their 2nd year of existence. And he helped the Jaguars get to the conference title game in 1999. There's still a chance he gets in, despite his short-lived career. Just ask Terrell Davis. Kansas City Chiefs, Priest Holmes. Widely overlooked throughout his career, Priest Holmes was among the game's most dynamic offensive playmakers in the 2000s. He was part of Baltimore's Super Bowl 35 championship team, but he took his game to another level after joining the Chiefs in 2001. Holmes would earn 3 straight Pro Bowl selections from 2001 to 2003. He had 8,172 career rushing yards
another
and
level
touchdowns.
After joining the Chiefs
he was
in 2001.
OPOY
selections from 2001 to 2003
and led the league in rushing twice. Holmes' 86 rushing joining TDs, the Chiefs by the in way, are good for 15th most all-time. That's an undisputed Hall of Famer if you ask us. Los Angeles Chargers, Walt Sweeney. Sweeney was a key part of the Chargers' 1963 AFL Championship team. He was a 9-time Pro Bowl guard and received first-team All-Pro selections in 1967 and 68. Sweeney was inducted into the Chargers Hall of Fame, but we're still waiting for Canton to enshrine him. Since when is a decade of dominance by an offensive lineman not enough to get in the hall? Oh, and there are still plenty more like Sweeney to discuss on our list here. Inducted into the Rams, Isaac Bruce, Kurt Warner, and Marshall Faulk, the two main components of the Rams' greatest show on turf offense, are in the Hall of Fame. Stud wide receivers Isaac Bruce and Torrey Holt are not.
Los Angeles
Rams caught the game-winning touchdown pass in Super Bowl 34 against the Tennessee Titans. He was the go-to guy in the passing game for
Warner.
The Hall of Fame. So how underrated is Bruce? Oh, he's Torrey
Holt
all-time in receiving yards
in
and
Super Bowl 34
in receiving touchdowns. So here's the thing: we all know that Bruce will get in. It's just amazing that it's taken this long. How nice would it be if he and Holt were inducted
in Super Bowl 34
together? Miami Dolphins, Zach Thomas. Well, at least Thomas is in the College Football Hall of Fame. Named to the 2000s All-Decade Team, Thomas was a 7-time Pro Bowler and 5-time First Team All-Pro. He recorded 1,727 tackles throughout his career, along with 16 forced fumbles and 20.5 sacks. Thomas did just about everything teams asked for in a linebacker. So the question is, what's the delay for his induction?
This world is just full of mysteries.
Minnesota Vikings, Jim Marshall. Alan Page, Carl Eller, Gary Larson, and Jim Marshall formed the legendary Purple People Eaters defensive line that dominated throughout the late 60s and 70s decade. Eller and Page are in the Hall of Fame. Larson and Marshall are not. The latter's absence from Canton is especially perplexing. He was part of the Vikings' 1969 NFL Championship team and earned a pair of Pro Bowl selections. Marshall also guided many to 4 Super Bowl appearances. He was the definition definition of an Iron Man. His 282 consecutive games played are the most ever for a defensive player. He was a finalist for the 2004 class, but Marshall was, well, snubbed. New England Patriots, Drew Bledsoe. If it weren't for an injury that cost him the starting job in 2001, Drew Bledsoe could have been the architect of the New England Patriots dynasty over Tom Brady. The legacy of TB12 makes everybody forget just how prolific Bledsoe was during his days with the Pats. But you gotta remember, this guy led the Patriots to a Super Bowl 31 appearance. He was a four-time Pro Bowler, so could have been the architect of the over Tom Brady 1994 season. And the legacy of TB forgot that Bledsoe led the Pats to the 2001 AFC Championship game victory when he came in to relieve an injured Brady. Bledsoe finished with 44,611 passing yards and 251 touchdowns. For what it's worth, he has won AFC Championship game to relieve an injured Brady. Johnny Unitas, and 250 Kurt Warner and Steve Young. Yeah, that's a Hall of Famer if you ask us. New Orleans Saints, Pat Swilling. The Georgia Tech product carved out quite a career with the Saints. He was one of the NFL's most dynamic pass rushers during his time with injured New Orleans. Brady. He won the 1991 Defensive Player of the Year award after leaving the NFL in sacks. He finished with 107.5 for his career, which is good for the Georgia Tech product carved out quite enough for the Canton Committee. Perhaps perspectives will change soon. New York Giants, Phil Sims, Lawrence Taylor and the dominant G-men defense were mostly responsible for the club's success in the 80s and early 90s. But come on, Phil Sims was instrumental in helping the Giants become one of the league's more dominant teams for over a decade. Sims won the 1986 NFL MVP award and was part of two Giants Super Bowl championship teams. In fact, Sims was named Super Bowl outdueling John Elway and the Broncos by a wide margin. Not only that, but Sims posted solid career numbers with 33,466 yards and 199 touchdowns. Injuries cut his career short. Two Giants MVP, two Super Bowls, and strong stats, Sims checks off most of the boxes to be a Hall of Fame inductee. Or at least you'd think so. New York Jets, Mark Gastineau. People never talk about the guy, but he was an absolute beast of a pass rusher during his tenure with the Jets, which spanned from 1979 to 88. He had 74 recorded sacks for his career. He earned Pro Bowl and first team All-Pro selection every year from 1981 to 85. So what's the Canton Committee waiting for? Oakland Raiders, Stephen Wisniewski. He earned Pro Bowl and first team NFL offensive linemen that continue to wait for their calls to the Hall of Fame. This includes Stephen Wisniewski, the 8-time Pro Bowl guard who played with the Raiders. Wisniewski was named to the 90s All-Decade team and earned a pair of first team All-Pro selections. He was one of the few bright spots on the Raiders team that struggled throughout Stephen Wisniewski. He was often overlooked throughout his career, and being overlooked often hurts your chance of getting into the Hall, sadly. Philadelphia Eagles, Pete Retzlaff. One of the most dynamic pass catchers of his era. His career with the Eagles spanned from 1956 to 66. He finished his career with 452 receptions for 7,412 yards and 47 touchdowns. Those were extremely high numbers in those days. Oh, and on top of that, he was a 5-time Pro Bowler. And he was part of the Eagles' 1960 NFL championship team. 352
receptions
for sure. Don't put him in the Hall. Whatever. Pittsburgh Steelers, Alan Fanica. The vast majority of all-time Steelers greats are already enshrined in the Hall of Fame. 9-time Pro Bowl guard Alan Fanica isn't one of them. He played on the Steelers Super Bowl 40 team. He earned 6 first all-team pro selections. He was named to the 2000s all-decade team and the Steelers all-time team. You honestly can't ask for anything else in a guard. 9-time Pro Bowl guard Alan Fanica. He played on the Steelers Super Bowl 40 team.
I mean, you gotta get into it enough.
San Francisco 49ers, Roger Craig. When people think of the 80s and 90s 49ers dynasty, they think of Bill Walsh, Joe Montana, Steve Young, Ronnie Lott, and Jerry Rice. Often lost in the pile of cornerstone players, running back Roger Craig, the 1988 NFL Offensive Player of the Year,
Ronnie
was a
Lott
key cog
Jerry
in
Rice.
San Fran's offense. He was part of three 49ers Super Bowl championship teams and earned 4 Pro Bowl selections.
Year was a
Craig
key cog in
8,189 career rushing yards and 56 touchdowns. All that's missing on his resume is a spot in the Pro Football Hall of Fame. Seattle Seahawks, Sean Alexander. Up until the 21st century, the Seattle Seahawks didn't have many Hall of Fame caliber players. That isn't to say Sean Alexander belongs in the Hall of Fame, but among retired Seahawks, he probably has the best chance of getting in. Alexander was a 3-time Pro Bowler who won the 2005 NFL MVP and Offensive Player of the Year awards, leading Seattle to a Super Bowl 40 appearance. His 9,453 yards place Alexander 36th all-time, ahead of Hall of Famers such as Earl Campbell and Larry Sanka. Yeah, you can make a case that Alexander belongs. Tampa Bay Buccaneers, John Lynch. Terrell Davis should be an inspiration to Lynch. Even if the wait is ridiculously long, he'll make it one day.
Everybody knows Lynch will get his call. It's just surprising that it's dragged on this long. Lynch, a key anchor of the Bucs Super Bowl 37 championship team, earned 9 Pro Bowl selections in his illustrious career. He earned a trio of first-team All-Pro selections as well. Hang in there, John. The Canton committee will call you eventually. Tennessee Titans, Steve McNair. One of the greatest dual-threat quarterbacks of all time, Steve McNair was simply on another level during his prime years with the Houston Oilers, Tennessee Titans franchise. McNair led the Titans to a Super Bowl 34 appearance, where they narrowly fell to the St. Louis Rams, as well as the 2002 AFC Championship. McNair and Peyton Manning were co-MVP winners in 2003, and the former earned 3 Pro Bowl selections. McNair was tragically murdered by his mistress in the 2009 offseason, and we still think he can be inducted. If that moment comes, it's just a shame he won't be here to see it. Washington Redskins, Joe Theismann. He probably would have been in the Hall of Fame if a gruesome leg fracture didn't end Theismann's career in 1985. But still, one can argue that he did more than enough to earn a call to Canton. Theismann played with the Redskins from 1974 to 85, throwing for 25,206 yards and 160 touchdowns. He won the 1983 MVP award and took them to a pair of Super Bowls, winning it all in the 1982 season. Very good numbers and a terrific individual resume. To us, it's a surprise that he never got inducted. It's never too late though. Maybe it'll happen someday. Who knows? Who are some other Hall of Fame snubs on your favorite NFL team? Join me in the comment section below. Also, what you should do right now is go follow myself and TPS on social media, because we post great content all the time. Tweets, Instagram, subscribe to my YouTube channel. I post videos every single week and they're entertaining. So, I mean, almost every week I try. Make sure to subscribe to TPS because we post videos all the time. All the time, new sports content. Why would you not want it? Go subscribe. If you like this video, give it a like. It takes one click right down there. Smash that like button. Smash it. Pop it. Drop it. Blab it. Okay, I don't know what I'm doing. I'm Jason Biondo. I'll see you next time. My knee.